More and more communities experiencing rats. What happens when a car gets stolen? What is the rest of the story concerning NGA? And what about that New Life Evangelistic Center's ongoing hearings and the pressures that are being put on it to try to stop from sheltering the homeless as the last major walk-in shelter? That and much more is going to take place on this program as I interact with Chris. Be sure you stay tuned. I'm Larry Rice, and this is Here's Help. Recent story in USA Today, metro area sees surge of rats. Well, I'm starting to see some more in the neighborhoods. In fact, one neighborhood after a neighbor told me about rats living under a dumpster, went for a walk, and sure enough, there they were, living under a garage, going in and out from under the garage, into the dumpster, feasting. Tried calling City Hall, hadn't gotten any response. And another one mentioned, another person in South St. Louis saying, I saw somebody steal a car. They dumped it this place. It ran off down the railroad tracks. Called the police. They came, looked it over, and drove on. They hadn't done anything about it. The stolen car in front of the place. Yes, see, the note stolen because you see them pulling the deck out of it. Well, what in the world's happening in a city? And then get this from your congressman. St. Louis wins selected for new Western NGA site. And the picture's in here of the congressman, the mayor, and an older woman to make a Hubbard, who's actually going to benefit big time from this. What in the world's going on in the city of St. Louis? Chris, your reaction?
I'm just waiting to see where you're going to go with all this.
Trying to say, heaven help us. I'm trying to go with, hey, folks, we need to pray. I mean, everything you read in the paper and often the stuff you see when you start getting down among the issues, when you start really seeing what's happening, you wonder, wow, Lord, kind of where are we going as a community? And then when I see the city wanting to spend $1.5 million to try to replace shelter, it's been in operation for over 40 years, $1.5 million in taxpayers' money to try to stop New Life Evangelistic Center at 1411 Locust Street, I wonder, well, who are the real rats in the deal, the two-legged ones or the four-legged ones? Well, the fact is that we need a lot of prayer at this time. A lot of people are hurting, a lot of people in need, and a lot of the real issues that affect people get sometimes fall through all this. They get caught up in NGA when it's not going to bring that many more employees. It's shifting one part of the city to another. The city, I'm glad the Blues won their games, but hey, folks, there's a lot more involved than just sports out there. There's real hurt and pain in this community. That's where we're trying to go with all this.
Amen. I agree. I think just to be specific, the Biddle House program that the city is has come public with finally. You can go on the city's website, and they actually have a breakdown of expenses, how much it's going to cost to run, and it does come out to about $1.47 million. And it's pretty clear that in offering this program, they're hoping that our numbers at NLEC will be reduced. I mean, the way that I look at this, however, is that the city has been trying to essentially do away with NLEC's services for, you know, the last 15 years. They've been trying to show how we have obsolete programs, and that, for instance, they're going to end veteran homelessness. I was just looking at stats on how many veterans the city counts in the 2015 PIT count. We don't have the 2016 results yet of their PIT count, but for 15, they still have 124 veterans staying in shelters. So there was no way in which they could say, along with other cities, well, we no longer have any veterans who are homeless. So this was the agenda of even the First Lady. You know, there's a real push to end veteran homelessness, which, of course, I applaud, but I think we should end homelessness for anybody who doesn't have a job. Should it end homelessness for anyone who's, mentally ill and who receives a government income but can't afford an apartment because they only get, you know, $700 a month, six something a month from both SSD and SSI. And they go from apartment to apartment, place to place, traveling all over. We should end homelessness for all these people. But we can't do it when the political will follows the market. I mean, like Bernie Sanders talks about how we're worshiping the golden calf of money in this country. He agreed with Pope Francis in that. That's what's happening. So as long as market rate on housing is over $1,000 a month for a $1,500 a month for, and then that's considered somehow low income for average individuals, the people that need that housing the most will always have to revert to homeless shelters. So no matter how much money, hopefully what people are seeing is that from the last 10 years, $40 million, $60 million thrown at the problem, no matter how much money you throw at it, they're not reducing the number of people that they see on the ground in downtown St. Louis. In fact, the numbers grow, and it's not the fault of those people that are actually trying to help the homeless. But I think that the real fault is in the way that that government approaches this, that they approach it only in terms of, less resources, but allocating them a certain way, which is what they're trying to do in ending chronic homelessness. And they're not addressing the fact that, how many tens of thousands of units of low-income housing have we lost in the city of St. Louis in the last 15 years?
And that's what I'm saying. It's the ongoing destruction of affordable housing. They'd say they want to end homelessness. You stick them in an apartment, the person can't afford it, and they're back out again. We see these people coming back round and round. Then they leave it up to the police to solve the problems all over. We're talking about the city of St. Louis. What in the world is St. Louis County doing? Mm-hmm. They're not doing anything. What's going over in Illinois? Nothing going on, okay? What do the police do? The police are called every time. The police are expected to be the social workers, supposed to be a psychiatrist, all of that, and solve all the problems as they cut mental health programs, alcohol and drug treatment programs. And so then police are so busy moving the people from here to there that when somebody grabs a car in Illinois, drives over to Missouri for a ride home, dumps the car, steals the tape deck, runs off somewhere with it, that it just leaves sitting there. The cops don't have a chance to investigate stolen cars in one of these communities anymore. They're so busy trying to move homeless people from place to place. They think they'd solve the problem by driving them out of the downtown area. They aren't going to go away. They're going to be in downtown area. We got to continue to help people. And that's what we're dedicated to here at the New Life Evangelistic Center. And we're going to be expanding our services, not just overnight. We're going to start daytime services when we see the city's operated bridge program cease in the month of June. And the city says now, if you notice, first it was 1st July, now it's the end of July, and I don't even know if they found anybody to operate their program when they give them $1.5 million.
They promised they'd be out of 12th and Park by January of, 2014? So it's 2015. So, they're just continuing to make these promises. I don't want to say that they're not doing anything, because I see that work is getting done, improvements are made, But it's certainly not really addressing the problem. And this is the issue, is that 10 years ago, they should have had enough shelter so that NLEC's shelter beds would not have to increase. That's the issue. The issue is not, is NLEC being negligent or a bad neighbor by offering services. The issue is really that the city has turned a deaf ear to the problems of the homeless, where I was among those who went to the city year after year after year and said, look, you've got to increase shelter beds. And they said, we will never have another shelter bed in downtown St. Louis. That was said to me by Antoinette Triplett. So, this is in a real way, this is chickens coming home to roost. But it's not a matter of doing away with our programs. It's a matter of them finally admitting that they have a problem and providing some services.
They'll let the rats live under the garages, run and eat freely from the dumpsters. But when the people want to sleep outside, boy, they'll come all over them and try to get them, lock them up, do whatever they got to do. I'm telling you, brothers and sisters, this is some messed up times. And it's not just in St. Louis. We see it in Springfield, Missouri. And try to just lay down for a few hours on a sidewalk in Clayton or some community. People have to sleep, and they're taking away people's basic functions to have a place to sleep. Well, I thank God for those who've exercised the faith and courage to come and speak up and speak out before the New Life Evangelistic Center appeal, before the building appeals board. And one of those individuals who came and shared was Tekka Childress. And let's hear a little bit of her testimony.
Without NLEC ensuring that the hundreds of people that it kicks out every morning actually get to the places where they can get services, the logical consequence is that this population that is visited upon the neighborhood each morning is going to commit these things. Perhaps not without the, not
I'm gonna
at the fault.
This is just Mr. Kistner testifying and not asking a question.
It's a question. I just didn't get to the question mark.
All right. Quickly get to the question.
Because I was interrupted in the middle of my question.
So if I could just say more than yes or no, then you can go on for a little bit.
So you understand what I was asking, don't you? I mean, these people are more likely to cause problems, right?
So you keep saying this. We are giving such a blanket image about all homeless people that is just unjust, I want to say. I will admit clearly that there are some things that happen in the public among the homeless that are, you know, that are misdemeanors, crimes, loitering, which I don't disapprove of loitering, actually, although I do on private property. I want to say that I think that you're really characterizing, you're giving this really bad characteristic about these homeless hordes of people climbing out of the building, scaring our neighborhood, which I have never seen that. I just want to say, I've never seen it look like that. People go out at different times a day. They are downtown because all the services are here, and I don't see them standing for hours in front of New Life any longer.
That no longer happens. I didn't mean to suggest that every homeless person is a bad person who commits these things.
Okay.
But given that you've already conceded that there's a greater likelihood that they are to engage in these behaviors, I'm talking about numerosity. I'm just talking about proportionality. I'm not throwing a blanket over all the entire group. So if you lived in the neighborhood, would you want to deal with this?
Absolutely. Absolutely. It's been my life, and I would do it until I die.
I'd be glad to do it.
And I would try to get them all housed, is what I would do.
Just accept it.
I think that I've known some people live in lofts who are delighted with some of the people who are homeless and have made relationships. And I think what I tried to do when I spoke at Christ Church Cathedral 2 years ago when this was brought up was to engage people from downtown to get very involved. We could get business people to help house those folks. All I'm saying is you want to say homelessness is a problem, I will agree with you. Causes problems in great number, obviously. New Life is not to blame for that, and New Life doesn't make it worse downtown because there are agencies all throughout downtown that bring these people down.
Thank you.
Chris, it's great to hear Tekka, and then we had others. Tina came out. I mean, people are starting to rise up at this time. You go to these hearings, you'll see that. In fact, Councilor, why didn't y'all, I think they asked Tina Bush, why don't y'all bring all this up before the Board of Public Service? Well, that Board of Public Service, white members of different departmental heads, they already had their mind made up. They did.
You know, I mean, they took like five different weeks and brought all these issues up, and they ignored it all. You know, they just essentially said that any testimony that Tekka had or that I had or that Ray had or you had was not credible. That's how they deemed it. And essentially saying that we were not telling the truth, that our statement did not count. And so, the thing that really bothers me, too, about this NGA deal here is that we see how politics is really what motivates the interest in the federal government moving to North St. Louis. They actually want to take monies that were designed for North County with their special grants that they had and millions of dollars, and apply them toward this NGA deal. It's kind of like the government just feeding itself. You know, rather than really bringing improvement, this age-old idea that when you go in to gentrify or develop an area, especially an area that's been, just kind of left alone, like North St. Louis has, for blight for the longest period of time. I mean, talk about rats. I mean, you got Paul McKee, who this guy just sits on this property for decades and does nothing with it, just sits there, and no matter how much they complain to City Hall about this negligent landowner won't do anything. And then what is City Hall's answer is to mortgage City Hall West,
which was the Abram building that they stole from the homeless. They stole that building, Abram building from the homeless as federal surplus property. Now they're mortgaging it after they gave it to Paul McGee to buy it back to make him a multimillionaire. So we see the crooks they're the real two-legged rats that are running through the community at this particular time, because people believe. I mean, and here you got like St. Louis Post-Dispatch that agrees with the city about almost anything they do concerning the homeless, and they act like they're some champion for the poor, and they'll let this gentrification take place right underneath their nose, knowing that 47 families are also going to lose their homes as a result of this GNA project as Mr. Paul McGee gets rich.
NGA, yes.
NGA.
But it's really sick.
Take them by eminent reins, what they're going to do.
The problem is the attitude about development, really, rather than neighborhoods, being able to really do their own development, that they have to invite in huge projects, and instead of neighborhoods being able to be self-sustaining, we see where North St. Louis is just kind of left to die, and then it's this white man and a white horse come to rescue them. The same white man who, owned the property and did nothing with it for years. And yet we see that everybody falls in line, from Lacey Clay to even the ministers and a coalition of churches. They all just say, well, hey, this is a good idea. We think this is great.
Don't come and speak out against the city trying to totally take away the last major walk-in shelter in Mid-America. But there are some that do care. And Tina Bush is one of those. She went and spoke out at that hearing. And let's hear a little bit from her.
Is that a good idea to have registered sex offenders staying across the street from a school serving, I believe, grade school, middle-aged students? Middle school agents, students, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
It is not a good practice. It is also when men come, they come at later in the afternoon when the kids aren't there. But it's not. It's less than ideal to have the school that where sex offenders are. But New Life has been there. The school came late at last.
I understand.
Okay.
You have particular concerns for children, correct?
Yes.
All right. Imagine that you were the mother of a sixth grade student at that school. How would you feel about the fact that there might be several sex offenders staying across the street?
I'm going to object. This calls for speculation.
Yeah. Do you think you can answer that question?
I can also say, how would you feel as a person who's concerned about children to have children not have a place to stay at night? So it's, the same kind of situation.
Let me make sure I understand. You cannot answer that question, right?
Okay. As a mother, I am a mother. I have three children. And I will tell my children, stranger danger, that if a stranger comes up to you, you have a way to go, a way to get out of that situation. So as a mother, I put my children in the care of a school all the time. And I would tell them, there is a thing called stranger danger. If a stranger comes up to you and wants something from you, you leave the situation.
So you feel comfortable with your child exercising the rule of stranger danger in this context?
At that school, yes.
So that you don't feel that there's an increased risk?
At that school, I would tell my kid, if my kid went to that school, and I would send my kid there if they were that age and I was in the area.
Stranger danger. That's all the questions I have.
I thank God for those that were willing to speak up and speak out, let their voices be heard. We've been hearing from Ateka and Tina. People are starting to wake up, though, Chris. It's taking a little time. I mean, we even had condo owners that come over and spoke out against their neighbors saying, look, they're in the problem that they said that there is.
Yeah. And we're really grateful for Tina Bush and for others who, you know, they didn't have to do this. They came and spoke on their own behalf, just about the things that they see in the community. And you know, it's those people who actually have their eyes wide open as to the need that that we have to hear from, because very often, you know, at neighborhood meetings and everything else, it's not the homeless that are represented. It's not the people that are having these problems that are actually represented. And this is what we believe in here, is people taking responsibility in self-representation, self-autonomy, empowerment. This is what we're fighting for. And I think that the fact of the matter is, we have so much polarization in our society. We have so much recidivism between people getting out of jail or prison and going back again, because of that real sense in which people feel like no matter how hard they work to represent themselves, you know, the system is rigged against them. And so the answer, you know, is one person at a time, caring, demonstrating care, but then also demonstrating that the right answer is representing yourself. I dare say that so many groups, even with HUD funding or otherwise, if faced with the same level of opposition that we have faced, would have just folded a long time ago, would have just said, hey, you know, just give up, go open somewhere else, try to seek grants somewhere else, do something else, but it's not worth the fight.
We're going to continue to fight for individuals like Karen Wingo, who went to the hearing after getting help at the New Life Evangelistic Center.
You mentioned that you had served various capacities at New Life over the years. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay. Did you ever do intake when people came into the shelter?
Mm-hmm.
You have to say yes or no.
Oh, yes.
Okay. Sorry about this.
Oh, it's okay.
Describe the intake process for me.
Well, when they come in, well, women come in between 3 and 4:30. They check in. We check their belongings, make sure that they don't have any weapons or any alcohol or anything coming in, and then they go up on the floor. And then basically, when they're up on the floor, they have to fill out a form, stating their name, if they have any type of psychological problems and things like that.
So you try to determine what psychological problems each person might have?
We don't determine it. They put it down on the paper.
So you rely on them to tell you if they do?
Yeah.
What about drug use? Do you ask people, are you a drug addict, or do you have any substance abuse problems?
No, we don't ask that.
Okay. So is there any, and the point of these questions is there any effort in the intake process to try and identify problems people might have and try and line them up with services?
Say it again.
During the intake process,
mm-hmm.
is there any effort made to identify people's problems, whatever problems they might have, and then try to line them up with services to help them address those problems?
When we do the intake is given to the woman who's over there, the women's program. So once we do that, it's out of our hands. I don't know exactly, you know.
You don't know what happens after that?
Right.
Okay. Did you ever, I know some people over there serve in a security capacity. Did you ever do that?
Yes, when I first got there, I did security on the women.
My understanding is that interior security in New Life is provided by people like you who are long-term residents. Is that right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Thank you. Is there any outside security brought in, like private security, inside New Life?
Yes, I've seen a gentleman there at night.
At night?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yes. Have it.
Now, it sounds like New Life has provided you and your family with pretty good benefits over the last few years. It's been good for you.
Yes.
Okay. Is there any reason New Life couldn't have done the same things for you if, instead of having 325 people, it had 85?
You said, do I think that they could have given me the same services if it was less people there?
Yes.
Yeah. Yes.
Yes. They could still operate their pantry and their clothing store, correct?
Yes.
And they could still operate a TV station?
Yes.
And they could still have given your family all the assistance that did give you if they, instead of having 325, they had 85.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
So many individuals like Karen have gotten help as New Life Evangelistic Center continues to fight for those that are hurting. And again, we thank God for Jeffrey Mintman, who is at 1501 Locust, who stood up and says, look, I look out, I don't see all those people coming out of that building that these other condo members are talking about. He says, we get more people coming to our office than we do that. So, yeah. And then you got so Hugh speaking out and Robert Lindsay from down at 1114 Lucas speaking up and speaking out. Praise God, they're good people. And that's what it takes is for good people to come out and testify at these hearings and stand up to these different politicians that definitely just want to push people out just because they're homeless.
Right. These are condo owners and residents and members of the Downtown Neighborhood Association. We have people who live in this building at 1411 Locust who are members of the Downtown Neighborhood Association. And this is what it's all about, is coming out, speaking up, telling the truth as you understand it, letting your voice be heard. As we think about what's been going on over the last number of years, I want it to be said in history for future generations that that NLEC was there, not just offering help and hope in the community, and that there were people in downtown who lived around NLEC who came out and spoke up and who fought this and who stood up in behalf of the homeless. And that's something that we have to be proud about. That's the side of St. Louis that I am proud of. Those people who are fighting for low-income housing in the community, those people who recognize the need of the NLEC being there, but standing up for the rights of people, of the homeless people to
be
there.
Well, you know, Jeffrey Mintman at 1501 Locust, he's the executive director of the ACLU of Missouri, and I hear so many Christians blast the ACLU. And here's a man that stands up and testifies in behalf of the very people that Jesus spoke up over and over about was the homeless. So where are all the Christian folks at? Where are all the people that are saying, you know, that's terrible what they say, you know, and how they contest and this and that and the other. But the fact is that he came and he spoke up at this hearing. So where are all the Christians that blast the ACLU that equally love the hurting and the homeless that come out and speak up?
It's a good question.
And they'll be asked that by Jesus someday when he says, when I was hungry, why didn't you feed me? Naked, why didn't you clothe me? Sick or in prison, why didn't you visit me? A stranger, homeless, why didn't you welcome me? As oft you've done to the least of these, even so you've done to me. I mean, we see the story of Lazarus and the rich man. When this community, Lazarus doesn't even, they don't even want Lazarus to eat the crumbs that fall from the rich man's table. They just want him out of the neighborhood. Mm-hmm. And what's he going to say to those that say, oh man, you know, it's terrible what the ACLU does and blah, blah, blah. And yet they won't even have the backbone nor the guts to come out and speak up in behalf of the last remaining walk-in shelter that's dedicated to our resurrected Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen. Amen.
That has a statue in front of the place showing Jesus on a park bench like that.
That's
well,
right.
I think we need to pray for our people, our churches, all the quiet people that are just letting the evil prevail in our community. That's what we're talking about, is we're talking about evil, evil people that, you know, I don't think they want to be evil. I don't think they see themselves as evil, but their actions that would drive people out of a community just because they lost a home. I mean, mm-hmm. What does it say about a society like that?
Well, that's right, and I think that that's why we still need to be here, and we need to, you know, teach the those that are ignorant, that are actually moving against what God has and is doing. I also just want to point out that the statue we have there of Jesus, the homeless one, they've been trying to put that into the Westminster area over in England and are getting fought, you know.
Yeah.
They're saying, we don't want that here. We've already got too many statues. But you know, it's an important statement. We have it right here in the city of St. Louis. It's the only statue of its kind here in the city of St. Louis. And it's here to represent Jesus, the homeless one. And so we're doing all we can at this time so that future generations can look back and say, NLEC was there. No matter how much the city or other groups tried to say that they weren't important or that they just needed to go somewhere else, they were there really caring, really helping people get back on their feet, get into housing.
And we were able to do that because of those of you that are sharing those much-needed gifts. with the New Life Evangelistic Center and praying, "You are the heroes." It's P.O. Box 473, St. Louis, Missouri, 63166. Thank you for caring and sharing. For more information, go to newlifeevangelisticcenter.org.